Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Cape Faith Church. How are we doing today? Oh, it's so good to see all of your faces in here today. Aren't you excited to worship the Lord? Every Sunday that we get together, we get to pour out our praise and give a sacrifice of worship through singing, through giving, and just through the fellowship that we have through the preaching of the Word. Aren't you excited? James Penswick is going to be preaching today. And I know that God has an important word on his heart that he's going to give us today through the Psalms. So I'm just really excited about all of that. I thought we'd try something a little different today. Normally, we would start out with a high-energy song, and we will do that. We're going to sing and praise God for who he is. But I thought we would start out with prayer this morning. So would you stand, and let's all pray together as we just welcome God into this place, open our hearts, and really get ready to receive the word.
Lord, I just thank you that we can gather. I thank you that we gather not just in this building, but we gather online as well. And I just want to welcome all of the Cape Faith family and new people, Lord, that maybe don't really have a church yet. I want to just welcome them on your behalf, Lord. They feel welcome. They know that we gather because we need you. And I pray someone would be inspired to open their hearts to you today, Lord. We bring our hearts to you this morning, Lord, and lay them just before you. We bring our troubles and our fears. We bring the things that are concerning us. We bring our children, lay them before you, Lord. And we also pray this morning for kids getting ready to go back to school. I pray you'd help them to lay their fears and their troubles before you, that you might be glorified in the way that you're going to do great things with them. I thank you this morning as we sing songs. We invite your presence. We invite your wonderful intentions for us this morning. Pour out your spirit, Lord, on every person here and online this morning. And I thank you that you are going to do great things this morning. In Jesus' name.
Good morning, church. My name is Marlene, and I'm one of the staff here at Cape Faith. There's a few things I'd like to highlight before we begin the service. When you walked in, you were given a bulletin, and one of the things that it covers are the important protocols that we need to follow when we gather. So please check that out, and thank you for helping us to create a safe environment for everyone. You'll find we have multiple ways for giving. You can drop your offering in one of the boxes on the walls. You can mail a check here to the church. Give online to capefaith.org/give, or you can text the phrase Cape Faith to 77977 on your smartphone. Lastly, I'd like to extend a special welcome to all of our guests today. Please take a moment to fill out a connection card so that we can get to know you better. Once again, thank you for worshiping with us today. Welcome home.
Yes, well, it is again good to be in the house of the Lord. If you don't know who I am, my name is Jesse, and I'm the worship leader. Like Marlene was saying in the video, there are multiple ways that we give back to the Lord through the mode of giving. And we used to do where we pass the baskets, and you haven't seen us do that in a while. And unfortunately, with all this stuff with COVID-19, it just doesn't really allow for us to have multiple people touching that one little thing. So we don't do it that way anymore. And so we've been doing it online, and that was a great tool that we were able to use. I don't know if you've ever used it before. It's really simple. We use one of the most secure giving platforms on the planet. It's called PushPay. And all you have to do is simply text 77977 on your smartphone and with the phrase Cape Faith, and it brings it right up. But the reason I'm encouraging you to look into these ways that we give is because what we do as a church, whether it's reaching out to somebody in need, supporting missionaries throughout the world, and also just providing resources and tools for you guys throughout the week. We all are adding to that through our giving. That's how our church functions. And so I'd encourage you, if you've never given before, now's a great time. It's not only just a way that we function, it's an act of worship. And when you give with a full heart and trusting that God's going to do something amazing with that. So I'd encourage you, if you've never worshiped in that way, I'd encourage you, that's a great way to do it. So let's continue now with worshiping through song. Let's stand and let's sing to the Lord.
Safe within your name.
Died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Shall return in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will ride among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Praise the name of the Lord. Face to face again. Would you bow your heads and pray with me as we go before the Lord one last time? Father, we sing your praise here today, for you are worthy. You are worthy of praise. And Jesus, thank you for the sacrifice you made, that on the third day you conquered death. You made us right with God, taking our place for the punishment of sin. None of us deserved it. None of us could earn it, because none of us are perfect, God. So we thank you for doing that in our place. Lord, thank you for your mercy. And that your desire is that none of us shall perish. So Lord, I pray for those in this room who don't know you. They don't know that great story. They don't know why we sing. They don't know why we praise you. I pray for that person today, that they know you. They come to know the saving knowledge of Christ. That we don't earn our way to salvation, that we can't do enough good things in this world to measure up to perfection, Lord. And so instead, you came down to us, lived a perfect life, died in our place, conquered death. And that if we would just trust in you for that, trust that your sacrifice was enough, we don't have to strive, we don't have to earn favor from God, Lord, that we just trust you. We be made right with you. Lord, thank you so much. It's a beautiful picture. A father's love for his creation. God, we give you the praise. Lord, we thank you. We pray this in the power of the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, everyone. You can have a seat.
How's everyone doing today? What a beautiful day, huh? Well, put on your seatbelts. It's going to be one heck of a ride this morning. My name is James Penswick. I am really grateful to serve as one of the elders here at Cape Faith Church. I hope you have been enjoying this summer series, the summer playlist, as we've been preaching through some of our favorite psalms. As you all know, psalms are just songs, and what we've been doing is taking some popular songs that you might hear on the radio and just using them as themes to preach through the much better songs, which are the psalms in the Bible. The psalms are some of the most honest and beautiful songs that have ever been written. Every human emotion can be found expressed in these beautiful works. There's joy and sadness, anger, fear, and love. They're all there. Compared to the Psalms, a lot of the songs that we hear today just lack meaningful, deep expressions of emotion. Are there any country music fans in here? Oh man, I'm sorry. Yeah. No offense. But lyrics like, I love my truck, or like, You took my t-shirt and my blue jeans. Like, there's shallow. I'm really sorry. I feel like I'm going to get cornered after this. Like, you don't even know. Luke Bryan speaks to my heart. He speaks to mine, too. It's just that a lot of songs today just don't express the realness that we find in the Psalms. Psalm 16:9 talks about joy. It says, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. Psalm 25:16 talks about loneliness, and it says, turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. The troubles of my heart are enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses. Psalm 42:5 talks about sadness and says, why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? And then check out Psalm 3:7. It says, arise, O Lord, rescue me, my God, slap all my enemies in the face, shatter the teeth of the wicked. That is my kind of song. I can just like picture Taylor Swift singing it, right? Like, smack them in the face, smack them. Your seatbelts are on, right? Like, we're just getting started. David in Psalm 51:4 says, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. He wrote this after he was called out for his sin, and he's brokenhearted, and he comes to God with just this realness and this openness and this honesty. And what separates the majority of the songs that we hear today from the Psalms in the Bible is that every single psalm points to God. From Psalm 1 all the way to Psalm 150, every single one points to God. They're very emotional, but they're not wasted emotions because the authors have their eyes on God. Their focus is on him. The glory goes to him. I think the most real that we can ever be is when we're open and honest while talking to God and confessing to him our deepest feelings. And the authors of the Psalms have captured that perfectly for us. Pastor John Piper says, more explicitly than all the other books in the Bible, the Psalms are designed to awaken and shape our emotions in line with the instruction they give. Confession time. This is bad. I actually really wanted to do Eminem's Lose Yourself as like the background song. Like, you better lose yourself in the music. You guys know it. Don't judge me. I know you all know it. Half of you were probably bumping it on the way to church this morning. And I was like, okay, you like lose yourself in God. Like, all right, I can make this all work. And then I found myself like warping scripture to make it fit the gospel of Eminem, and I realized that that's bad and you guys should probably find another elder. So Keep Your Head Up by Andy Grammer, that was the song that I chose. It's certainly not a Christian song. It doesn't point us to God directly, but the idea of keeping our heads up so that we can keep our eyes on God, as in like our thoughts being focused on him, that's an idea that I would like to expound on this morning. And just to be very clear, this is not a self-help sermon. I'm not saying like, hey, just keep your head up and be positive and everything's going to be okay. We know that's not the truth. We know that life throws us curveballs all the time. But what I am saying is that because God keeps us secure always, it should compel us to keep our eyes on him and our thoughts on him and trust in him no matter what happens in our lives. And I think sometimes even in the literal sense, lifting our heads and our eyes to the heavens, it starts to put things into perspective. I heard a testimony once of a pastor that was struggling with an addiction to pornography and his sin. It's closed in, he's alone, it's dark, he's trying to shelter out the world as he's committing the sin. And his true breakthrough came when he was so sick of trying to fight it himself that he stepped outside, he looked up to God, he saw the sky and the light shining down, he put things in perspective, and he realized at that point just how powerful God is in relation to the size of his sin. God has the power to overcome any sin in our lives. So before we go any further, let's pray together, and then we'll read Psalm 121. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this day that you have made. I pray, God, that we would rejoice, that we would be glad in it. I pray that our hearts would be filled with gratitude, even in spite of the craziness that is going on in the world around us today. Help us to keep our eyes on you in every situation. I pray that the words of Psalm 121 would truly speak to our hearts this morning, and it would give us a renewed love and a desire to seek after you. We love you, and we pray this in the matchless and perfect name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Psalm 121 is known as a song of ascents, as in ascending, like climbing a mountain. And there are 15 songs of ascent in the Bible, Psalms 120 through 134. And they were sung by devout Jews as they were making their pilgrimage to the highlands of Judah, where Jerusalem was located for the annual feasts. And I can only imagine that these pilgrims must have had such hope and joy in their hearts as they neared the end of their journey and they could see the hills in the distance, knowing that their trip would soon come to an end and culminate in a time of worshiping God and his holy city. And the author of this psalm, albeit weary from a long trek, just lifts his eyes to the hills and knew that his help came from the Lord and no one else. So let me ask, do we trust that our help comes from the Lord as we travel this journey of our day-to-day lives? Do we trust that God, the maker of heaven and earth, is in control of all things? That phrase of God being the maker of heaven and earth is repeated over and over again in Scripture. We read it in verse 2. So why is it repeated? And I think it's that the authors wanted us to stress that God has universal, unlimited, unbounded, and unparalleled power, and that nothing else can hinder that. Basic logic states that if God were any less powerful than what he is, then something else would be greater, and therefore his power would not be unlimited. But that's not the truth. He made it all. He controls it all. So if we're going to look for help, let's start there. And the truth is, we don't oftentimes. We think we know better, so we fix our eyes on other things. To make it personal for you, before I was saved, if I was feeling depressed, I'd look to a bottle of pills. If I was feeling anxious, I tried to find peace in a bottle of alcohol. And even after I was saved, I still struggled for about a year, fixing my eyes on God, allowing him to be Lord of my life, and allowing him to have control on my life. And all this did was create this dog chasing his tail kind of situation. I was even so convinced that if I could just change locations, that my life was going to be okay. So if I just moved, everything would be better. And so from Sandwich, I lifted my eyes to the promised land, Falmouth. Falmouth was going to be my saving grace. And so you know what happened when I moved from Sandwich to Falmouth? I still brought my rotten self along, and the problems followed me. I never found what I was looking for until Jesus Christ found me. Here is a truth that you can take to the bank. It is vain to trust in creation and in created things when we should be trusting in God. the Creator. Our first action should always be to go to God. And if we're being honest, it isn't always our first reaction, but we need to acknowledge who He is and that we trust Him and His guidance to lead us. We need to keep our head up and our eyes lifted to see Him for who He is and all of His glory, the Maker of heaven and earth. And so this brings me to 2020. Where are your eyeballs at, brothers and sisters? What are you spending your time looking at these days? What are your thoughts on? It has been quite a year. Australia was burning. Kobe Bryant died. There was an impeachment trial and protests and murder hornets. And Tom Brady became a Buccaneer. And then Gronk too. And then there was the Tiger King. Tiger King. I'm not sure I have ever watched anything in my life that made me feel so good about myself and where my life was at. If you guys haven't seen Tiger King, it's okay. If you're here today and you love Jesus Christ, life is good. And then there's COVID. COVID is crazy. I never thought I would have become a connoisseur of toilet paper before in my life. I never thought face masks or neck gaiters would become a fashion statement. But in all seriousness, COVID has completely affected every aspect of our society and how we interact as a people. It's had huge ramifications on jobs and our economy. It's affected the way your kids go to school. It's been politicized, it's hard to know what's the truth. And it's obvious even right now here in church that it's affected the way that we operate as a church. It's just a hot mess. But let me ask you, does COVID in any way take away from the fact that God is limitless in His power? No. The same God that created the hills in the psalm is the same God who created you and I. He holds the universe in His hands. He's aware of all our needs, and He provides, and He protects, and He keeps us secure, even in this age of COVID. So our eyes should be on Him always. Hebrews 12:2 says, "Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith." And not just when times are good, not just when times are bad, but all the time our eyes should be fixed on Jesus. Every morning when we open up our eyes, let's be a people that prays that God would not only have His way in our lives, but He would have His way in our society, and that He would use us to tell others about the hope and salvation that can only be found in Jesus Christ. So many lost people trust in the vanity of this world instead of the hope that's in Jesus. And people are desperate for answers right now because there's so much uncertainty. They live in fear because of all this chaos, and we have the remedy for fear, brothers and sisters. We have the message of hope. Jesus Christ is the hope of the world. It's not politicians, it's not the government, it's not self-help books or afternoon talk shows. Hope will never be found in a pill or a drug or a bottle. It will only be found in a life surrendered to Jesus. That is the message of hope. So let's pray for the boldness to share that. You know, someone was once bold enough to share it with me when my life seemed out of control. So why wouldn't I want to share it with someone else? So why? Why should we keep our head up? Why should we keep our eyes on God? I have 3 points this morning. Point number one, we should keep our head up because God keeps watch always. God keeps watch always. Verses 3 and 4 say, "He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep." While we're on the topic of songs, do you remember that song, I got a feeling somebody's watching me? You guys remember that? My wife is legit having a heart attack in the back right now. She's like, I tell him not to dance in public, and look what he's doing. He's dancing in front of the church. What a moron. So 80s music is my guilty pleasure. So I'm sorry for judging all you country music fans. You can judge me. We're even. But the song is true. There is someone always watching us. God is ever watchful and guarding us at all times. God is watching and protecting like the good father that he is. So why fear when the creator of everything is watching over our lives? Proverbs 15:3 says that the eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. 2 Chronicles 16:9 says, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to give strong support to those whose heart is blameless toward him. God never sleeps or slumbers. He isn't like us. He is aware of everything and everyone in the world at the same time, all the time. He is always vigilant at keeping watch, knowing exactly what we need and protecting us. When I was young, my parents would sometimes take my brother and I up to Boston to a sporting event or go see a show, and I just remember how hyper-vigilant my parents were, especially my mom, to make sure that her eyes were on us and make sure that we didn't stray in the city because she wanted to keep us safe because she loves us. We have a Heavenly Father whose eyes never stray from us. And when we stray, we have the Holy Spirit to convict our hearts to steer us back on the right path because he loves us. So why wouldn't we want to keep our eyes on him? I spend far too much time with my eyes down here and not enough time with my eyes up here trusting in God to provide every single one of my needs. We're a fickle people, aren't we? We worry about what we don't have, and then we worry about what we do have, like it's not going to be enough. I know for me, COVID kind of exposed that. Like, will I have enough of this, or will I have enough of that? In Matthew 6:25 through 34, Jesus tells us never to worry. If God feeds the birds, then he will certainly take care of us. So there is never a need to worry. So we should keep our eyes on God because he always keeps watch. His eyes are always on us. Point number two, we should keep our head up because God keeps guard always. God keeps guard always. Verses 5 and 6 say, the Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. Let's be clear. When it says that the sun shall not strike you by day, it is not saying that you won't be sunburned. So wear your sunblock, party people. Don't be crazy. The psalmist here, though, is using figurative language to explain that nothing, either of the day or the night, can harm us if God is keeping guard. He is our covering against every calamity, our shade against the visible perils of the day, as well as the hidden perils of the night. It's confession time again. You guys just love the dirt, don't you? That's a heart condition right there. You gotta better check yourself. I don't like the dark. 43 years old. I'm just going to be honest, straight up. I don't like it. I'm not going to say I'm afraid of the dark, but I'm afraid of the dark. So now, in all fairness, before you, I can feel the judging, so it's too late for that, but nothing will ever stop me from going out in the dark. I just don't like it very much. Every year, my wife and I go camping up in northern New Hampshire, like way northern New Hampshire, just a couple miles south of the Canadian border, and there's no lights around at all. There's no ambient light from towns or cities. It is just dark, really, really dark at night. And I have one of those LED headlamps that they're so bright you can like see into someone's soul. You know what I mean? And I will completely freak myself out because the light is so focused. I just am looking throughout the woods like praying something isn't going to be at the end of that light tunnel like Bigfoot or something. It's so stupid and so foolish. Seriously, what type of peril could I encounter that would derail the fact that God is still my protector and the keeper of my soul? God is our ever faithful guardian. Alexander the Great was once asked how he could sleep so soundly when he was surrounded by so much danger all the time. And he replied that Parmenio, his faithful guard, was always watching him. So how much more soundly should we go about our lives knowing that God, who never slumbers or sleeps, is guarding us? The maker of heaven and earth is guarding us. So we should keep our eyes on God and keep our head up because God always keeps guard. And my final point, point number three, we should keep our head up because God keeps us always. God keeps us always. Verses 7 and 8 say, "The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore." The point of Psalm 121 is not that we won't experience problems in life. Of course we will. The point is that God will keep us safe as we go through those problems. The promise of Psalm 121 is not that we won't stumble or stub our big toe. The promise is that no injury, no illness, no accident, no distress will ever have evil power over us. There is nothing that will be able to separate us from God's purposes in us. Listen to the words of Paul the Apostle in Romans 8:35 to 39. "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, 'For your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered.' No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen. Every danger that the Apostle Paul wrote about in Romans 8, he had experienced himself, or he was in danger of experiencing. He was eventually martyred for his convictions. He faced extreme difficulties, yet not one of those things ever separated him from the love of Jesus Christ. And today, he is in the presence of the Lord. In John 16:33, Jesus said, "In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Thank you, Jesus. Pastor and author Eugene Peterson writes this: "The Christian life is not a quiet escape to a garden where we can walk and talk uninterruptedly with our Lord. It's not a fantasy trip to a heavenly city where we can compare our blue ribbons and gold medals with others who have made it to the winner's circle. The Christian life is going to God. And in going to God, Christians travel the same ground that everyone else walks on, breathe the same air, drink the same water, shop the same stores, read the same newspapers, are citizens under the same governments, pay the same prices for groceries and gasoline, fear the same dangers, are subject to the same pressures, get the same distresses, and are buried in the same ground. The difference is that each step we walk, each breath we breathe, we know we are preserved by God. We know we are accompanied by God. we know we are ruled by God. And therefore, no matter what doubts we endure or what accidents we experience, the Lord will preserve us from evil. He will keep our life. It gets better. I promise, sweetheart, it gets better. So, what do we have to worry about? Is there anything so great in our lives today that God cannot take care of? This year, it's COVID-19, but the reality is that it's going to be something else. It's right around the corner. We don't know what's going to happen as soon as we walk out the doors this morning. So let me ask, what type of people will we be? Will we dig a hole and bury our heads and hope that we fall asleep and wake up in 2021 and that it's going to be better? Or will we try to trust in earthly things to bring us hope? Or will we keep our heads up, keep our eyes on God, and continue to embrace Him as the Creator and believe that He is in control and that there is nothing in this world that can separate us from His love? As I was preparing and studying and praying for this sermon, I realized that the best part of this psalm is that God's watchful and caring eyes being on us is not dependent on our eyes being on Him. It's not like, if I keep my eyes on God, then He will keep His eyes on me. The beauty is that His eyes are always on us. Even if we go astray and have our eyes elsewhere, His eyes are still always on us. And I don't know about you, but when God showed me that, it stirred up such a joy in me that I just desired to seek Him and desired to spend more time with Him so I could know Him more. My father passed away a little over 2 years ago. Sorry. My wife and I lived with him the last 10 years of his life and helped him out. His health wasn't great. And every morning, he and I would have coffee together. He was a retired captain in the Merchant Marine, and every stereotype that you can conjure up in your mind about a salty old sea captain, that was my dad exactly. That man could make cursing poetic. It was a gift. My mom didn't like it so much as my brother and I were going around like, hey. My dad got in trouble a lot. But he had the most amazing stories of being at sea all over the world. He had stories of being in storms that would just boggle the mind. I remember him telling a story of being in a storm in the Gulf of Mexico. And the ship that he captained was 700 feet long. And he said that the waves were so big in the Gulf at the time that the ship he was on, it just felt like a toy in a bathtub. The waves were just so big. And his stories were compelling, very, very compelling. And luckily, he had pictures to prove most of them. But like any sea story, there's always this tiny element of doubt, like, did that really happen? We all know that sea stories are notoriously embellished. I'm sure we all have a fisherman friend who went out and caught Moby Dick when you know that it was like a guppy or a flounder. But God has given us the greatest story that's ever been told. It's the story of His Son, Jesus Christ, from Genesis to Revelation. It's the Bible. And unlike sea stories, every single story in the Bible is true. They've never been proven otherwise, and they never will. And it's okay to have questions like, really, Lord, did that really happen? I think to have questions is to be human, so I would encourage you to spend time reading the Bible, spend time in prayer, asking God to reveal the truth behind the things that might not make sense. I do it all the time. If God's promises are true, if He always keeps watch over our lives and guards us and preserves us from evil and keeps our lives, then nothing should derail or detract us from desiring to keep our eyes on Him and spending time with Him. Let's not get caught up on what's happening down here on planet Earth. Or rather, let's not let it own us. It's totally natural to have concern for your lives and the lives of your family members, but don't let that concern turn into anxiety and turn into something that takes our eyes off of the Lord. One thing that I do every single morning is I ask the Lord to make me grateful and remind me of the good things that He's done in my life when I start to complain, because man, I can complain. I swear it's like a spiritual gift, like a bad one, one that they don't talk about in the Bible. But in praying that, the Holy Spirit is quick to remind me of all the good things in my life. Today, I am not a drunk. Today, my life is different. Today, I have a loving wife and a loving family and a job and food and clothing and shelter. And best of all, today, I am saved by Jesus Christ, my Lord. And when I'm reminded of that, the complaints just melt away. In Philippians 4:8, Paul tells us to fix our thoughts on things that are truthful and honorable, just, pure, lovely, commendable, excellent, and praiseworthy. And you know what the outcome is when we fix our thoughts on those things? The outcome is the peace of God. I don't know about you, but boy, do I need peace in my life every day. This COVID-19 thing stinks. It stinks. I want it to just go away and disappear. I'm sure we all do. But if there's any good news in this, it's we are all in this together. Brothers and sisters, we are all in this together. So let's be a people of great patience and great grace. Let's be examples to the lost by our love for one another. Let's let people know that they can find true hope and peace by putting their faith in Jesus Christ. And the only way that we will ever be able to do that is when we're able to keep our heads up and keep our eyes on God. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you so much for today. You are so good all the time. Thank you for always keeping watch, for always keeping guard, and for always keeping our salvation secure by the power of your love. May our lives be a reflection of the same love that you show us. God, when we leave here, please help us to be a light for you in a community, Jesus, that needs to know who you are. We have that message of hope. We pray for boldness to be able to share that message. Jesus, it is all about you. I thank you for being part of a church that glorifies you all the time. I thank you for my brothers and sisters here that love you. God, use us in a powerful way to see people saved here on Cape Cod. And God, we want you to receive the glory that you are due. We love you, we thank you, and we pray this in your great and matchless name, Jesus. Amen. I love you all so much. Thank you so much for letting me share today.
James, man, you crack me up. thank you, James, for bringing the word today. Thank you all for being here today. Before you go, we have an announcement. We've been announcing that we were going to have our summer baptism at Dallas's Beach today, but we haven't had anybody sign up for one yet, which isn't a bad thing. It just means that we're all saved, and now we need to go find some new people to share the gospel with so they get baptized, right? So my encouragement to you is, Share your faith with people. Share the gospel with those, just like James had contended us to encourage us to. And I love you all.
Thank you for being here. If you want to go out, one more thing. I also remember that if you are like not knowing, like, hey, do I want to get involved in something, but I don't know where to start, there's a ministry opportunity for you. If you speak to Jason Houle on your way out, he would love to let you know about our First Impressions ministry. It's just the friendly face that greets you when you come into church. And if you'd love to volunteer that, go see Jason. Other than that, thank you, everybody, for being here. You're dismissed. Have a great day.